morning.
Glad you could be here with us. And also to our audience that will be worshiping with us on YouTube, we give you a welcome too. Any convenience to you, we would love for you to come and be with us in person if you're in town. I have a couple of announcements to make. But first, I want to encourage you to come on Wednesdays at 1 for Bible study. This past week, we just finished up the book of Revelation, and we're going to do the book of Daniel, beginning Wednesday at 1. Glenn does such a wonderful job with it, and we have participation and prayers, and it's really just a good hour together and kind of breaks up the week. So I would encourage you to come if at all possible. Also, thank you for the ones who picked up your shoeboxes last week for Samaritan's Purse. Thank you, thank you. And if you haven't, or if you know someone that would like to take a box or two, please do so. We still got some that we can fill. I was reading an article this week from Franklin Graham. This will be their 30th year of doing shoeboxes and sending for. They're here in the United States, but they do go around the world. And at that point, I think it was 207 million boxes have been distributed. And of course, it continually needs. So prayerfully consider that. And we certainly need to pray for all those that are involved in that. Prayer concerns, Elizabeth Johnson passed away this week. Let's remember her family. Sandy Cox Jones passed away this week. Her mother, Judy Delk, was our church secretary many years ago. She was, and I remember Sandy and her sister sometimes would come with her mom, and they would play outside, and Jesus work. So sad time for them. She was, you know, still a young lady, woman, and I know her family is in deep sorrow. Prayer concerns. The main one right now that's on my mind is Lucella Lewis. Lucella is making her way to leave us and to go into the arms of Jesus. She struggled now for quite some time, and she has such a sweet disposition about her. I've known her for probably close to 20 years. Got to know she and Charlene, well, and Glenn too, but the women especially. We worked together in the American Cancer Society, and she was such an advocate of that and worked so hard for that, she and Charlene did, and she was always a joy to be around. And go down to the Carroll County High School and have our Relay for Life. She was there selling food and making her bows to make money for the American Cancer Society. Glenn and Charlene are tired. They have given her such good care, kept her at home, and hospice is helping them, but I hope that Glenn wouldn't mind me telling you this. I heard it on the radio airways this morning as he was talking to his friends coming into town, so it's around the world already. He has spent most of the night with her, sitting with so Charlene could rest, and talking to her and singing to her. So truly, she's going to go out in a very peaceful way. But let's especially remember them and in the coming days. And she has one son, Bill, and one grandson, Chuck. So, are there other prayer requests? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, we need to pray for Israel.
Israel and, well, people in the Gaza Strip, the whole thing. We just need to pray for God's will. And I'm afraid that's not happening right now. And then, yesterday, Afghanistan was struck with more earthquakes. Our world is in such a turmoil. Anyone else? Carly?
Some of you may have heard this week, a 15-year-old boy shot himself. Well, it's accidental. And his grandmother, I grew up with, and he's my neighbor. And one good thing, and he was killed. I mean, he was a brain dead as soon as he got to Brothers. But one good thing that came out of this, 15 years old, his parents donated all of his organs to be used. And they had a walk of honor for him on Thursday. As they all lined up down the hall as he was wheeled into the harvesting area. So, Dylan Ritter, but it's devastating for everyone, the family and all of our neighbors too. You can remember that. And I don't believe everybody here around. A lot of times it's just stuff made up, but it was an accidental shooting. He was just being killed late as well.
Are there other announcements or concerns? If not, then we will begin our service. We pray that there be mercy upon her, and that she can join you and be reunited with her family, but most of all, see Jesus. Give Glenn, Charlene, Chuck, and Bill your strength as they go through this time. We know that you will carry them. And we thank you that you do that. We are concerned about those who are not in your fold. Help us in any way that we can to witness to people of your love, of Jesus' forgiveness of our sins and his death. We don't want to be bold in a place that would make it uncomfortable for them, but help us to be a kind witness that will make people think there's something special about these people that know Jesus. Because he loves us so. Died for us, and he gave us this prayer that we can always remember. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If you're able, let's open our service with our song of praise and worship. Praise him, praise him.
Haven't done so, open up your communion and we
we will sing, "There is a fountain filled with blood."
Blessings. We are truly a blessed people.
want to especially remember that as we work this in the coming weeks, fill our boxes to send out to the world, to these poor little children that are so needy, that we love them too. Thank you for the privilege of serving you. With all of this, we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And he shall judge among the nations, and shall rebuke many people. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Let us pray. God our Father, we are so thankful today for the fact that you don't keep us in darkness, but you shed light along our pathway about your nature, who you are and what you are. But beyond that, Lord, you also enlighten us as to things unfolding in the future of humanity. And we pray that we might be observant, that we might look about us and see the signs that you speak of, both in the Old Testament and the New Testament, so that we would not be taken unaware, but that we would recognize the day and age in which we live, and that we might redeem the time and hasten the time. Lord, we pray for the many who are dull of hearing, who lack understanding, and who lack a desire to know of you. We pray that we might be given tools to interrupt their walk as they follow the evil one. We pray that we might break from them the bread of life, and they would embrace it, and they would surrender themselves unto you. For in you is life everlasting. In you is peace that passes all understanding. And in you is the gift of eternal life through your Son, Jesus our Lord. So bless us this hour as we look at your word together and as we worship you. Continue, Lord, to answer the prayers that have been raised here audibly and the silent prayers that people have prayed in their sin. May you act on them according to your will and glory. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, Isaiah was a prophet who prophesied of things that would shortly come to pass in Israel. And also he prophesied of things that were far-reaching. This is true of most of the Old Testament prophets. They had a here and now effect, but also there was a long-range effect that would take place in the future. For example, prophecies concerning Jesus Christ, only about 20% of the prophecies concerning Jesus was dealing with his first coming, and 80% was given concerning his second coming. And the Jewish people have combined both together and seen this all as one event. But what we see here is contrary to the teachings of Jesus to believe that this is all one event. For example, we know that Isaiah prophesied. He said that a child would be born, and his name would be called Emmanuel, and he'd be called the Prince of Peace, the Everlasting Father. He would be called a number of different things, and he said that, and of his kingdom there would be no end. And this was the prophecy concerning Jesus' first coming. But this passage of scripture deals more with an event that follows Jesus' second coming, when he catches away the church. We know that Jesus had his disciples to go up into the Mount of Olives with him in his Passion Week, the last week he lived. And on Thursday night, he taught them things that he wanted them to know and to understand. He taught them about something that was going to unfold 40 years after his death. Whenever they looked down from from the Mount of Olives on the sunlight shining upon the temple that his disciples were marveling at Herod's temple, which had just recently been constructed. It was 70 years in the building. And as they marveled at it, Jesus said, the time is coming when not one stone would be left upon another. And his disciples said, Lord, when shall these things be? And what is the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And we would tend to think of that as a singular question. But really, they were asking three questions, but they didn't know it. Lord, what is the sign of thy coming? And Jesus, in the 24th chapter of Matthew, went into great depth about signs that would unfold right before and during the time of his second return. What is the sign of thy coming? And they went on to say, and the end of the world. Now they thought that nothing could destroy the temple short of the end of the world. It's a magnificent structure. But you know, Solomon's temple was destroyed, was leveled to the ground. So it happened before, so they should have expected this could happen also. And so the Romans were so distraught with the conduct of the Israelites that in 70 AD, which was about 40 years after Jesus' crucifixion, they marched into Judea and they slaughtered the people. And people thought that they would find safety in the temple. Surely these Roman soldiers would not follow into the holy place or into the Holy of Holies. But the Romans pursued after them, and the blood of those who took refuge in the temple ran down the steps of the temple. And there was not one stone left upon another that was leveled to the ground. The only thing that stands of the original temple is the Wailing Wall. This is the place that Orthodox Jews and many other people who visit Israel go to and worship and pray. And also with the Jewish people, quite often they will write out prayers on a piece of paper and stuff them in the cracks and the crevices of the Wailing Wall. Miraculous things have happened. There was a separation in World War II between families that was vast, and small children, of course, as they grew into adulthood, even if they escaped the Holocaust, they would have changed over time. Their parents would look pretty much like they were in World War II, but the children would have radically changed. And so a man was looking for his son, and he wrote out a prayer request, and he stuck it in the crevice of the rock there, the Wailing Wall. And there was a young man there who saw something uniquely familiar about this older man. And he thought, well, maybe I can tell something from his prayer. So he went and he removed it from the crevice in the rock and opened it up. Was a prayer from his father, hoping to find his son. And this young man who pulled the prayer request out was the son of that man. And so they were united through the prayer that was left there in the Wailing Wall. So that's all that remains of the original temple that dates all the way back to Solomon. But the temple that it was worshipped in was leveled to the ground. So they thought that this had to be the end of the world when this happened, but the world didn't end. 2,000 years has elapsed since that time, and we are still here. But there are things that Isaiah wrote about that were yet to come, and very early here in his writings, he talks about the attraction of Israel to people from over the world, that they would come and they would gather there in Judea and in Jerusalem, and they would say, let us go up to the house of the Lord that is established on the top of the mountain. Jerusalem is up about 2,500 feet, and everybody in Israel, when they talk about going to Jerusalem, they say, let us go up to Jerusalem. If they come from the north, they say, we're going up to Jerusalem. If they come from the south, they're going up to Jerusalem. Usually here in this country, if we're heading north, we're going up. And if we're heading south, we're going down. But there they spoke of elevation. They were very close to Jericho, which was about 1,200 feet below sea level, and Jerusalem was about 2,500 feet above sea level. So it was over 3,500 feet difference in elevation. So a lot of the priests had winter homes in Jerusalem where they were responsible to serve in the temple for 30 days out of the year. And then they had their winter homes down in Jericho where it was nice and warm, but they didn't have to worry about snowfall or anything down there. Cause the difference in elevation. But the people would say, let us go up to Jerusalem, and many people shall come and say, come ye, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. So he said that there would be an attraction Israel to Jerusalem. You know, the Israeli people were scattered, and a lot of the prophets wrote from two different locations. They wrote some who remained in Israel, who were not carried away captive, wrote, and then those who were carried into Babylon and who later were under the rule of Assyria, the Medo-Persian Empire. And they sort of had a different message. The Jewish people wrote and said, for we have hung our harps on the trees beside the river. They felt they had nothing to rejoice for because they had been removed out of Israel and they had been carried into a foreign land. And so the major prophets talked about the coming of the Messiah. They also talked about his second coming. And it wasn't always in chronological order, because here in the very early verses of the book of Isaiah, he's talking about a time that is beyond the second coming of Christ that we refer to, where the church is called away. And he talks about something that's going to happen. He says, and the people, they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their pruning hooks and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. No military training, no preparing for warfare, and no warfare being occurring. Today, if we go to New York City, we'll find the United Nations building that the U.S. built there, and nations from all over the world gathered, trying to maintain a peaceful atmosphere throughout the world. And we've not been very successful in doing that. But there is a symbol there from Isaiah 2:4, and it says that there's a monument, a statue, of a man who has heard finder's fire, and he's there, and he's stuck one of these double-edged broadswords into the flame, and he's pulled it out, he's put it up on an anvil, you see him with a hammer, and he's been beating on this broadsword, and it has been expanded out. Instead of a sword, it's coming out in the shape of a plowshare, that man would not learn war anymore, but they would take and destroy their instruments of war. Well, now, when is this going to be? Jesus talked about near the end, as the disciples says, Lord, when shall the end come? What is the sign of that coming at the end of the world? Jesus said, there will be wars and rumors of wars, and there will be pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places, meaning there would be multiple human disasters that would be taking place across the globe. But he said, but the end is not yet. These are just the beginning of sorrows. And then later, of course, the end would come about. He talked about that it would be a great time of tribulation, of trouble, as such as has never been on the earth before. And so this is such a deep experience of desolation and destruction that the world has never experienced it before. And that 7-year period would end with the gathering of nations from all over the world. And the Confederation of Nations is mentioned in another major prophet, the book of Ezekiel, as in the 38th chapter that he talks about what's going to happen. He said that these nations would gather together. There would be Gomer and his bands, which is Germany. And right now, Germany is at peace and everything with Israel, so that's not happening right now. But Gomer and his bands, and also that nation of the north that's bordered by two oceans, two major bodies of water. Gog and Magog, and they would come down out of the north. And so Gog, if you visit over in the Mediterranean area today, and you look at the crest of the Caucasus Mountains, and you ask somebody, what is that? They'll tell you, that's the Gog. After over 2,700 years, it's still known as the Gog. That is the southern border of Russia. Russia would come down against Israel, and also other nations that would be coming. There would be one army that would come out of the east of the Tigris and Euphrates River, which is where Iraq and Iran is today, in Mesopotamia. And they would come, and there would be 200,000 horsemen. They didn't know the number of million, so they measured everything in thousands as the most logical, large quantity of anything. And then they would multiply that. They would come with thousands and thousands of these, and the number of them in today's math is 300 million horsemen out of the east. Well, today the population of the world is at such a point that there are nations east of the Tigris and Euphrates River that could amass an army such as that. During the time of World War II, we could not have put together an army of that size. When I was going to high school, the population of America was only half that. Every man, woman, and child, 150,000 people was all we were. Now we're over 300,000. This nation is coming out of the east, across the Tigris and Euphrates River, into this valley of Megiddo. There in Israel is going to be a massive army. And all of these things are going to take place before this period of tranquility. And the thing that makes that tranquility so readily possible and everything is found in the book of Revelation, Revelation 23. We find here in Revelation 23, verse 3. And this is, the scripture says, cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. So what Jeremiah, Isaiah is talking about is when the spears and swords will be beaten into instruments of peace and farming, is a period when Satan is cast into the bottomless pit. He's not out bothering the world. We know that James described what Satan was about after the crucifixion of Jesus. James was the half-brother of Jesus. And he said, be watchful, be careful, because of your enemy, Satan, the devil. He's walking about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he might devour. So Satan is loose, and he's not putting the end up today. He's making plenty of headway. He is known as a liar, and the author of lies. And therefore, he's out spreading lies in order to create tension between nations and between individuals. And we know that he was an instrument of destruction from our first parents. They were in the garden and they were enjoying peace and tranquility until he showed up. And there he saw Eve and caught her there near the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And caught her looking at the fruit that was forbidden. God said, you can't eat of this fruit. And the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. Well, you know, I would assume from that that if you took a piece of fruit from that tree and took a bite of it, you'd be killed just like that. But no, that wasn't what God meant. That meant that death entered into the world and that the pronouncement of death was upon Adam when he died was 956 years old. But the seed of death was already planted was partaker of the fruit after Eve encouraged him. And so therefore sin entered into the world, and Paul often talked about that the first Adam, through the first Adam, sin entered into the world, and through the second Adam, which is Jesus Christ, the cure for sin came into the world. And so these things would come to pass. So the prophet Isaiah talked about things that was going to happen shortly. He talked about things that would happen 760 years after he spoke these words. The coming of Jesus, the coming of the Messiah unto you. A child is born unto you. A Savior is given. And that didn't happen for 760 years. And then following that, he talks about this stage and age in which nations would learn war, no war. There'd be no more warfare. And this was a time for 1,000 years that Satan would be captive of that bottomless pit. He would be locked in it. And then he would be released for a little season. And then eventually death and hell and Satan and all of his angels would be cast into the bottomless pit for eternity. And so this age that is talked about is often referred to as the millennial age. And because of various views, there's been a lot of church division over that. When is the millennial? And they come up with three major views over thousands of years, a couple of thousand years. One is post-millennial. People, especially in the 1700s and 1800s, they believed that the millennium had already happened. Well, I don't know of a thousand years that the earth has been without peace, I mean, without warfare. I don't know of a time that we have beaten our plowshares and our spears and implements and our swords into plowshares. An age like that has never existed yet. Those millennials say it's already happened. And then there is the all-millennials, and they believe that the millennium is going on right now. I recall attending a church in California, and the minister said, it's really wonderful to see the peace and all that we have that we're living in, and soon righteousness is going to set the world straight, and we'll be able to invite Christ back to come and to rule and reign with us. Well, we're not going to be inviting him back. He's going to come back on his schedule, but we're not going to schedule him to come back. And then there is the premillennial view that before Jesus, before the millennium, it would be the catching away of the church. And then the millennial age would follow this after the time of tribulation, 7 years. And then after that, we would go into the eternal age where we would ever rule and reign with Christ. And so the prophets have much to say for us today. I know some people used to refer to the Old Testament as the Old Bible, as though it was passé. But when people came to Jesus once and said, "Good Master, what must I do to be saved?" He said, "What does the law say?" Well, the law is the Old Testament law, and it basically is the first 5 books of Moses, first 5 books of the Old Testament. That's the law. And this one man said, "Lord, all of these have I observed from my youth up." And what he had observed was supposedly that he loved the Lord his God with all of his heart, soul and strength, and he loved his neighbor as himself. And he took a deep breath and was ready to go on with 9 more laws. Jesus stopped him and he said, "This do thou shalt do." He hadn't been able to keep the first law. And how many in the world have ever been able to keep the first law? That we actually love the Lord our with all our heart and soul and strength, and love our neighbor as ourself. And our neighbor, who is our neighbor? It can be our very worst enemy. Can you love your enemy? In the Old Testament, you heard quoted that you're to love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Jesus came along and said, "Oh, I set before you a new law. Thou shalt love both thy neighbor and your enemy." And he certainly did this at the cross. But it's real interesting with George Washington and Valley Forge. He had a real problem that winter with heavy snowfall and hunger and disease. Far more people die there from disease than die from combat wounds. It was very few of those that took place until after they left the Valley Forge and came back. But he had a problem with desertion. People got homesick, people got hungry, people had been sick, and so they deserted. And so it became such a problem that General Washington says, "Well, we're going to have to start executing people who deserve it." And so this one man, who was from Lancaster County, Pennsylvania, which was a neighboring county to Schuylkill County, where the Valley Forge was, and he deserted, possibility of execution. And so they allowed witnesses and everything. And so during the trial, they had this man who was an old German Baptist out of Lancaster County, came to testify on behalf of this observer. And so General Washington asked him to testify, and the man got up. And he talked about pleading with Washington. He says, please spare this man's life. Please don't take his life. He's a neighbor of mine, and so forth. And he wept for the man. And Washington said, sir, he said, I have no sympathy toward this observer. But he says, I'm really moved with the fact that you walk through all the snow and you travel all these miles over here to Schuylkill County to be a testimonial for this man who is your friend. And the man said, General Washington, this man is my most bitter enemy. Here he came to testify for his worst enemy, pleading for this man's life. And so, how many of us love our neighbor as ourselves? Jesus will one day ask, who is your neighbor? And the crowd said, when they had recited the first and second commandment, that the man asked, who is my neighbor? And Jesus said, well, let me tell you a story about a man that went down in Jericho, and he got beaten and robbed and left for dead. And a priest came by and looked, passed on by. Another, another Jewish person came by, and he went over and looked at him and went on his way. And then finally a Samaritan came by. He stopped and he bound up his wounds and he took him to an inn and made sure that he was cared for. And then Jesus turned to the people who had asked, who is my neighbor? And Jesus says, which one of these three men was the neighbor? And the men couldn't choke out the word, the Samaritans, because they hated the Samaritans. But he said, he that showed mercy. Man that showed mercy. So God calls us to keep the commandments, which none of us can. But he gives us eternal life because he paid the price for our sins. And have you accepted that? Have you accepted the testimony of Jesus Christ, who is willing to be an advocate for you, to stand before the throne of God and say, yes, he had sins, but they've been cast as far as east is from the west, never to be remembered against him anymore. And therefore, I've told him that whosoever confesses me before men, I will confess before you, my Father. And he did, and he does. And so are you ready